So I'm the lead on the C++ Portable Components open source project. Just to do a little gauging, how many people have heard of POCO here? Okay, how many people have used POCO? We got some. Hopefully, if you haven't heard of it or used it yet, you will after today. And I currently work at Sysdig as a senior software engineer. We do performance monitoring for Linux and cloud, Docker. But back to the presentation today, what I wanted to prepare here and show is a combination of C++, JavaScript, and WebSockets that allows you to create distributed application in a very simple way in a very complicated language like C++. So as Bjarne Strostrup likes to say, anything can be done simple if you have a good library in C++. But without a good library, yes, things are very complicated. So what I'm going to be talking about today, first I'm going to give you a little overview of POCO for the benefit of the people who haven't heard of it and not familiar with it, so the rest of you please bear with me. Then we're going to look at the remoting library. A remoting library is a library built on POCO for remoting. And it used to be a commercial product, Applied Informatics, from a guy who started POCO, Gunter Obilchnik, and he open sourced that recently. Then we're going to talk about OSP, which is an open service platform. It's an application server, basically. We have plugins that you write, and they run in this environment, and there's a lot of convenient features inside the environment that make it easy to exchange the data and get all kinds of services out of it. I'm going to talk about how JavaScript is integrated into all this. Then we're going to talk about WebSockets, see a little WebSockets demo between a couple of browsers and the backend application. And at the end, I'm going to mention Machina.io, which is Applied Informatics. It's a commercial product that is built on POCO and OSP, so just to show that there is a real-world application that's using it, and it's being used in production, and it works well. So, POCO C++ libraries. The idea behind the libraries were to create something like Java and .NET have. It's a big set of often used components that you may encounter in everyday work from a practical standpoint that without a good consistent library, it's kind of hard. You're picking bits and pieces here. And that was the reason why I joined very early on the project, basically 1 month after it was released by Gunter. I looked at it and I said, this is what I was looking for. This is what I need. Before it, I used Ace and Boost, and don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that's bad code. There's a lot of good stuff there, but there was some overall feeling that was missing. So when I found POCO, it was basically said, hey, this is what I need. And I've been there ever since. It's been 11 years now. It's focused on the solutions to frequently encountered everyday problems. Say at the time, back in 2004, if I had an XML, I had to go and use libxml2, and if you ever used that, it was really a painful thing, and anything else that you would try to do, you have to try a different library, different style, and it was kind of painful. So that's what POCO brings to the table. It's a consistency. It's a you kind of have conventions, and your code looks the same wherever you go. It's focused on internet age, network-centric applications, so there's a strong support for networking, as we will see later. So it's really simple to create a small web server or a TCP server or SMTP client. It's very simple to do that in POCO. It's 100% standard C++, so you can go from one platform to another pretty much without a pain. It's pretty much you write once, compile anywhere. It is based on, it complements the C++ standard libraries, so one of the principles is we do not reinvent the wheel. If it's in the standard library, we do use it, unless it's a vector bool. We don't. but we do believe that there is a merit to using things in the standard library and not duplicating them. Now, at this point, after the C++ 11, those things may not be true 100% because we have our own threading from before C++ 11. But it's a relatively simple task to put the front end to it and just use the standard facility behind it. highly portable, as the name says. It's open sourced, it's licensed under Boost software license, so it's very liberal. You can do with it whatever you want. You can use it commercially, closed source it, modify it. You don't have to give it back to us. We appreciate if you do. This is what it looks like. So basically what you have at the bottom is your platform. Then you have C, C++ standard libraries, and then there's a POCO foundation library here. So you will see that we use those standard libraries, but where they are not sufficient, then we go directly to the platform. And then on top of that, what we have is we have various libraries like XML, JSON, ZIP, and so forth. We have the data set of libraries, and there are new things coming here. There's a PostgreSQL support coming. And then here we have the util library, where there's an application configuration and similar utilities. There's a net library with all kind of net related things. And then there's net SSL, which is basically a wrapper around net that gives you secure networking in conjunction with the crypto library. There's other libraries, there's MongoDB, there's other libraries that don't get released, but they are on the GitHub, so you will find them there, and they pretty much work and they're used in production. So as I mentioned, POCO was started in 2004. Currently, it's around 300,000 lines of code, more than 1,000 classes. We've been on GitHub since 2012, and it's been one of our best moves. If you've ever been on SourceForge, you know there's no comparison. Productivity and collaboration, it's day and night. We have around 100 contributors, which of course are not all active at this time. People come and go. At any given time, we have maybe around a couple of dozen people contributing on a regular basis. I've been leading the project for, probably like 7-8 years, and Gunther is the founder and also another one of the leads. And then we have some people who are dedicated to different parts of the framework. And as mentioned, Boost license, and here is the website where you can go and get POCO. Any questions so far? Anybody has any questions about POCO? Okay, good. So remoting is a library that it's separate from POCO. Currently, it exists in the Machine.io, which is also another open source project that is built on POCO, and we do plan to take that remoting out as a separate library and create a one library in between POCO and the Machine.io, which is partially commercial project, but there is a big chunk of it is open source. And I will show you what is planned to be taken out from the Machine.io into the this OSP and friends kind of package that we don't have a name yet for. So remoting is one of those packages. And it's a C++ implementation of remoting, similar like what we have in .NET or Java remote method invocation. And there's a code generator that parses annotated headers. So basically there's no separate IDL per se that you would have, like say a protobuf or similar systems where you have a separate IDL and then you have a compiler that takes it. In this implementation that we have, is basically what you do is you annotate your classes in the headers, and then you pre-process them. There is an XML file, but it's pretty much generic. You don't have to change it if you change your code. If you add some classes that you want or some functions that you want exported, you just do that in the header, and everything gets run automatically. Your code gets generated, and you can use them. It supports different transports, supports TCP, which then is proprietary. Of course, if you use TCP, you have to have the same remoting partner on the other side. But SOAP and JSON RPC, that works pretty much transparently with any other peer that supports that. It's also used for automatic C++ to JavaScript bridging. We'll show that later what it looks like. V8. We use V8 to provide support for JavaScript. How many people are familiar with the V8? Know what V8 is? Okay. So it's a Google JavaScript engine. It's used by Chrome and Node.js. It's written in C++, and it's relatively easy to integrate and extend. What it does, it takes the JavaScript and compiles it to native code. It has great performance. From what I know, it's probably the best there is out there for JavaScript. And it's BSD license, so pretty liberal. You can do whatever you want to do with it, including closed sourcing and so on. Open service platform is, as I mentioned before, it's an application server that is OSGi inspired, and it's implemented in C++ and it's built on POCO. Well, it is, it's a dynamic module system which is based on bundles. The unit of execution, your application, is a bundle, and a bundle is just a zip file with your executable, which is a shared library or dynamic loaded library, however you want it. And then there's some accompanying metadata there, like the manifest of what's in there, the configuration files, and so on. What OSP gives you, it gives you dependency and lifecycle management, so you can basically determine which bundle depends on which bundle and the order of loading and the version control. So if you put a new bundle in a dedicated directory, the system will detect, okay, I have a new version, it's going to extract that. You can also upgrade bundles at runtime. What you can do is basically, you can shut a bundle down, drop a new file, bring it up. Just the individual bundle, when I say bundle, it's basically a shared object gets unloaded from memory, and then you put the new bundle there and you load it back and it runs. If everything else is in order, of course. If you have some dependencies or version problems, then that's not covered. It has services and service registries. So basically what services are, services are bundles really that provide some kind of a service, and they register with a central location within the framework, within the OSP application server, and then they're available to all the other bundles if they have permissions to access them. They're very easy to do. Some of them come with the OSP and they're ready to go, like there's a web server service. So you can just ask for the web server service and you create your handler for your HTTP requests and you just go. As a matter of fact, to be correct, and we can take a look at it later, with the web server, it's even simpler than that. It's just a matter of configuration. There's an extensions configuration that you can put for a bundle. You say, okay, here's my extension point, and my handler for this kind of extension point is in this bundle, and then you write that handler. So you say, this is my extension point for a web server. It's located in this binary, and this is my handler function, and it's going to be called automatically when you assign it to that URL, that path on your URL. So, as I mentioned, web server. And this is what OSP looks like. So, what we have in the heart of it is you have your platform, and there's an operating system, you have standard libraries, you have POCO, so all these things we've seen before. And then this is the system part of the OSP system. So you have a service registry. Then you have the lifecycle management, where you can install, resolve, start and stop, uninstall bundles. Here's the bundle management that manages the versions. And then there are standard services such as web server, there's a console-based management. Some of these things are actually commercial. There's still parts of it that are commercial, but most of it is open source. And what you can do then with it is basically here's where your applications come. You write the bundles that are basically loaded and then utilize this system to provide certain services. And you can make, it's very easy to make your own bundle of service. You just register with the registry and then the other bundles can access it and get that service. Now, so this is the part that basically currently is this part here, these three libraries are currently in the Machin.io, which is open source. You can Google it and you can find it on GitHub. This will be taken out as a separate library because it makes sense. Machin.io is more dedicated to embedded world where you want to access embedded devices, sensors, and things like that, whereas this is a more general purpose sort of functionality. So we do intend to take that out of Machin.io and make another library. We don't have a name yet. If you have any proposals, get in touch with us. So it's all built on, of course, POCO, where you get your platform abstraction. And then with remoting, you get serialization, remote methods events, IPC, you get JavaScript support. There is also commercial Python support. It's not open source, but if anybody's interested, there's a Python support. And then there's the OSP, which basically gives you the functionality to put all that together and make it stick. With OSP, so basically what you can do with OSP with this support is your bundle can be C++ or JavaScript. And then the C++ is exposed to JavaScript, and you can call your C++. Or it's kind of like Node.js, but it's multi-threaded, so every bundle's gonna run its own thread. So it's, and you can call things that will launch threads from JavaScript, which makes it a little bit tricky. So, on to combining POCO and V8. So JavaScript is single-threaded, and it's garbage collected. POCO is multi-threaded, so obviously there's a challenge there. To make C++ object available to JavaScript is relatively simple. If your object is static, you don't have to worry about cleaning up after yourself. If you have to worry about cleaning up, then it gets a little bit more hairy. So there is something to help you here. There's a callback function that garbage collector will call when the object is deleted, and you can hook into that to clean up your objects. However, if you have little scripts from the script ends, that's not going to be called. If you create new objects from JavaScript, they're going to remain hanging. So for that purpose, we had to basically have that being tracked whenever your JavaScript creates a new object. It has to be tracked and it has to be cleaned up when your script is completed. But the support for it is in there. The remoting part. So this is what an example of remoting header looks like. Very simple example of a time service. So basically, if you want to expose your whole class, here's a little annotation. You just put a comment with @ and you say remote. This will export the public members of the class. The generator will take that and that remote gen XML, which is pretty much generic. So this is the only thing that changes over time. Create remote XML, remote gen XML one time. And then if this changes, you just rerun, you know, the generator just gets rerun and all this gets expanded into proper source files and headers. Or if you want to expose individual function, then you can just annotate one function and only that function will be exported. The remote gen looks like this. As I said, this is pretty much generic. So you put your includes here. There's a little bit of a description. This can be server, client, or both. So you can generate files for server or for client or both. And then there's a compiler section when you tell it what to do with the compiler, how to generate your headers and source files. And then there's also support for other compilers. The one before was for CL, that was Microsoft, and there's also GCC and Clang. That's pretty much simple and similar to the previous one. And this is what it looks like. You take the header and you take the remote gen XML, and what you get is a lot of files. So basically you have this service here, which is a parent to your remote object and your proxy. And then there are helpers here that kind of prep all that nicely so that it's easy and convenient from your code to call the remote code. So this is what the parent for that time service would look like. It's basically, it's reference counted. Here's your pointer, and then these are the generated functions. As you can see, the current time that was exported is pure virtual here, so it will be implemented in the remote object and the proxy, which inherit from this parent class. So this is how it all works. You call your service proxy, the serialization takes place, then you go through a transport, which can be either a TCP or SOAP or whatever you have there. On the other side, it gets deserialized, gets into the service skeleton, and then calls the remote object. What is built in is if your remote object is running in the same process, it will find it, and it won't go through the network to find the thing that is in the same address space with you. The response is synchronous. The response is synchronous. So this is what it would look like. Is basically you have a URI for your service. You find the service for that URI, and then you call the function from that service. What OSP does, it kind of wraps all this for you in a more convenient way, so you don't have to remember all those URLs and everything. You can just put them as the services, and it kind of happens behind the scenes. The JavaScript wrappers for C++ objects, so you have a similar thing, kind of like this. So it's a sensor, which is inheriting from a device, and there's a value and ready members here, and then there's an event. So this is where you get that asynchronous aspect of the call with this event, where you can basically just watch, and when it happens, then you can do whatever you need to do. So this is what the code would look like within JavaScript wrapping within the OSP context. So essentially what you would do is you would find a certain quantity within the within your application server, and then you would return an instance of that service. So basically you would get a sensor in this case, and then you can essentially watch that event. And when the event happens, you can get the data out of it. Or you can call it directly and say, okay, if it's ready, then give me the value, which would be a synchronous way to call it.
Is the event triggered from the C++ side or the JavaScript?
C++.
It's,
yes, it depends what your platform is, you know, Windows events or signals. So basically, there is a POCO event that wraps the underlying platform functionality, so you can just get whatever your events are on your platform. Next thing that we have is a web event service. Now this is now we completed the story about the remoting and all that. Now there's a web event, which is a separate thing, but they can kind of be used together. You can compose them. We're gonna take a look at the bigger picture of one of the slides later. What web event is essentially, it's a reactor, and this reactor basically is a part of a publish-subscribe system where you can subscribe to certain topics, and you will get notifications when those topics change, and those notifications will arrive. It can be either remote, they will arrive to you through WebSocket, or if you're in process, they will arrive to you through event. And it's all transparent. We're gonna look at what the code looks like for that. So it's a publish-subscribe pattern. It supports notifications through WebSockets, and it has a transparent in process and over the net asynchronous communication. So you can do server client or client client or whatever kind of combination of messages you want to send there. They'll go through, and this is all asynchronous basically. We implemented ping pong because you don't have it within, you can't really ping from just using JavaScript API, so we had to implement that at the application level. Now here's what the event web protocol, web event protocol looks like. It's very simple. You can put in the message whatever your heart desires. So you subscribe to a list of subjects that typically you want to name in a hierarchical manner, like reverse, you know, like com.poco.something. And you give it the version, and that's pretty much all there is. Once you send that with the list of subjects, you're subscribed, and whenever a subject changes, you will be notified of a change. You can unsubscribe, of course. And then the notify, basically, so if you want to post something to the system, you give it a subject name and you send data. And in data, you can put whatever you want, JSON, XML, whatever you find appropriate for your application. So subscriptions are hierarchical. So if you have org.poco.events and you subscribe to that, it will also receive anything under it. So what does the code look like? Okay, so here's what it looks like when you're within the OSP system. What we do here is basically we go and look for the service by name, which in this case, it's a web event service. And we get a smart pointer for that service. With a smart pointer, we basically have to cast that into the web event service pointer. And then here's the event, your notification, essentially where you subscribe to anything that is published under this topic, you want to know about that. And then what you have to do is you have to create a handler for that event. So this is how it's done. It's basically use a delegate. This is it's a POCO delegate, C++ delegates. And you say, okay, here's my function that will handle whenever something happens on this topic. And then here's your handler. Oh. I hate Keynote. Okay, let me make sure I don't skip over it. Okay, so that's pretty much what it is. It's really simple. What you get here is you will get your notification event. And this is just a pair of values. It's a key value. So you have a name and you have the content of the message. Yes.
Is this multi-threaded? Is it in one main thread, or does POCO instantiate a separate thread for these sorts of callbacks?
The callbacks can come from any thread.
So when the JavaScript sends something happens from the JavaScript, it comes from the WebSocket. Is there?
Well, from the WebSocket, basically there's a reactor, okay? So there's a reactor that just polls, you know, your set, whatever is, you know, if you have a e-poll or whatever is on your platform, it's just going to poll through it, and when there's something on the socket, it will post it.
Okay, so it's not a threaded server, it's a
polling. Yes, that's what's behind. So no, it's not launching thread for every request. No, for performance purposes, of course, it's polling. And the goodness of WebSockets, if you're not familiar with the goodness of WebSockets, is that they have framing, so that everything will come. It's not like you have to see, okay, where am I in the message, and I didn't get everything. You get it all or nothing. So that's really nice. And we're going to look at this live. I have a little example. So on the client side, basically, if you want to post something to somebody who's listening, so this is still in C++. And you're basically, again, you're finding your service, you're getting that handle of that service, and then what you do is you notify this, and then you put some data in there. It's going to come into the handler, and it happens all behind the scenes because it's an event. So wherever you're running this, which is probably what you wanted to add, wherever you're running this, that's where that handler is going to run. I'm sorry?
Notify
No, the notify, it's asynchronous. Okay, I have to, there's an entity in between, which is basically queuing up your notifications, and then it's posting them. So it you know, if you really look at it, strictly speaking, it will, all those will be in the same thread. All those handlers will happen in the same thread. But they can be, the notifications can be sent, of course, from multiple threads. When you do this, when you do notify, it goes into the notification queue, which then queues them up and then dispatches the notifications to the handlers. So there's a middleman between here and the handler. It's all built in POCO. It's all open source. So. And if you want to do something over the network, okay. If we want to do something over the network and from another language, then we can do a JavaScript from, say, a browser, and this is also part of the example that we're going to take a look. So what we do here is basically this web event server. This is not a standard JavaScript. There's a small library, maybe 100 lines of code, that's just wrapping the WebSocket API, the standard WebSocket API. It's kind of like an adapter for the web event functionality. So the web event server is my own little contraption between the JavaScript and the web event on the back end. So what you do here is basically create a new web event server, and then you give it handlers for the events that you want to be handling. In this particular case, we only are handling on open and on message. There's no on error and things like that for simplicity. True, I think true is for logging, but I don't remember anymore. It's not important in any case. It's not a very significant parameter. So here's your on open. Basically, as you can see, you subscribe, just like we did before from the C++ code. We subscribe to that topic, org.poco.demo. And here's our handler. So when the data arrives, it will arrive at this response. And then inside the response, we're going to have data. And then we have to do a little bit of splitting to find, okay, which part is it? Because it's just going to be a string. So we have to basically split the topic from the actual payload. And this basically, this line here is just to ignore the echo, because what happens, these are the joys of asynchronous program. What happens basically, you subscribe to this and you start posting, then you start getting your own echo, because you're also subscribed and notifying. So to filter that out is basically, if you find what you will see here, essentially, so here, I send event, which is this org poco demo, but I added a UID just so I can filter it out here. So when I see that my own echo is coming back, then, but you can arrange things differently if you're doing this kind of programming. And that's pretty much it for the client side. This will work, as I will show later in the example. So this is a big picture of what's happening. Yes.
Wait, you just decided to make the protocol text-based rather than the protobuf or
simplicity, but hey, it's open source. If anybody needs protobuf or something, you know, more better performing, you're welcome to contribute. But this is just for simplicity. This I actually used this in production for a number of years, the web event, and it works just fine. I mean, it depends what your needs are. If you have a really high performance needs, then you probably will do something more, something faster and more optimized. But for many, many cases, this just works fine. Did you have a question?
Did you say it generates the serialization code also, like for JSON and XML, based on your annotation?
No, you mean for the payload? No. No, for the web event, you know, there is no web event. Is just like a payload is a dumb string. We don't care what's in it. So you're responsible for the parsing, and there's a lot of improvements that could be done there. Just not enough time. I have so many ideas, but you know, just two hands. So this is a kind of like a big picture of everything that we looked at so far. just to give you a maybe a re review of all that's been said. So what we have is it's an OSP process. That's what you have, and inside that process, you will be running some bundles, which are, as we mentioned, just DLLs really running inside your executable. And then you have this web event service, which really is just another bundle that provides certain service. And we have the remoting functionality. So, and here's another service. So if you need to exchange the data, say between these two bundles or between a bundle and here, there are multiple paths on how you can do that. You can call via remoting, or you can call things directly. Say for, what I found services convenient for is if you need a global variable, just make it a service. You don't have to worry about it. You know, you need some object that you need to be globally available. You just make it and you register it with the OSP environment, and it's there. You just get it from there and you use it. You don't have to worry about where do I declare it and where it's visible and all those things. So you can do remoting between the bundles, or you can do remoting outside, and you can do events between bundles or events with the outside entities. So there's a lot of paths to transport your data, and it's from my experience in using it, but then again, I wrote a lot of this stuff, so from my experience, you can be very productive with this, and you can create distributed applications in a real quick and convenient way. So it's demo time. So what we're going to look here is basically just a really simple example where we have an OSP enabled application running. It's running the web event service, and then we will have two browsers, and we're just going to pass the data back and forth. The code, basically, this is the code for the client and the web browser. It's what we looked over a while ago. This here is the library that I mentioned. It's just a small library, maybe some 100 lines of code that basically wraps the standard JavaScript library. That's where this part is coming from, the web event server. That's just a little JS that wraps the standard stuff from JavaScript. And then we have a file server bundle. So what this file server bundle does is basically it does two things. Its primary purpose is to serve files. It's a web server. So the files that we get in the browser are coming through the file server bundle. And the way that happens is essentially what we have done here with the file server bundle is, so we have two files in that bundle. We have the bundle activator, and then we have the file server request handler. And the request handler is the one that handles your HTTP requests. What this bundle does is basically, it's a really simple web server. If the file exists, it will take a file and send it back to the client. That's it. The way it can do that is because here in the extensions for this bundle, we have said, okay, so here's our thing that we're extending. So that's osp.web.server.requestHandler. We're extending that. We're mapping this extension to the root path. This is the class that actually is going to do the work for us. It's in this library here, so in this bundle. And then there's a few more things here. So allow specialization if you can, basically, because you can just tie it to one resource, say one file. You can limit it, say, okay, only get this file and nothing else. Or there's a thing that you can, then there are permissions, and then there's just a description. So what happens with this, this is all there is just a config file. This config file, when your bundle is loaded, gets picked up by the OSP and it gets mapped to the web server as a handler for anything that comes to the root. And then your handler here, basically, this is where it's handled. There's a handle request in your handler. So there are two important classes here. One is a factory. This factory is long-lived. It lives throughout the process. It's basically whenever the request comes, it will give you the handler. So the handler is created for every request. And in this case, it is created in a separate thread. So it's a threaded server. So don't try to send 100,000 requests because it's not going to do well. But the shortcoming of that, we still don't have really true asynchronous I/O. We have a reactor in POCO, and we've been getting ready to do asynchronous, but I found this WebSocket stuff to just do it for me. And it would be nice to have something asynchronous, but I don't have a dire need for it anymore. Because with the WebSocket, what happens with the WebSocket, you launch one thread on the initial request, you upgrade that to the WebSocket, and then you're just open. So, but if somebody is inclined to contribute asynchronous I/O, we will gladly accept the contribution. So basically, this is what the handle request looks like. You have your request response, and then you log something, and then you look if the file exists, and if it exists, you just send the file back. That's what sends you the file that you request from your browser. And then the web event portion, I just crammed it here in the bundle activator. In the better design system, of course, it wouldn't be here, but it was really so simple that I didn't feel like creating another class. And here's what a typical bundle activator looks like. So you have your start and stop functions. So one of the things that is important, you know, with the bundles is that things that you need to initialize, things where your OSP environment is fully available, are not available at your activator construction time. So that's where there's a start and stop, and that's where you want to do things that depend on the facilities from the OSP environment. And so what we do here, so you will see this here in the bundle activator, there's nothing about, the bundle activator doesn't even know about the web. The web is all in the back, in the background somewhere, in that extension and that handler. But the bundle activator doesn't really have to do anything about it. It's all picked up by the environment and configured. Here, what we do here is the code that we looked at later. We get that web event service. And we essentially register our handlers, and then here we have. Here's the notify. Just a little patching here. If you just get /r, you add the end line, just so it looks better on the command line. So those are the building blocks of this system. Is all clear? Does anybody have any questions? Okay, good. So let's take a look here. So we have, all right, so we run this application, it runs, refresh. So when we refresh, the file handler, the file server bundle handler gives us the HTML and JavaScript and everything that this page needs. And then if we type something here, we can see it appearing here and here. Or if we go to the other window, we can see it just going back and forth, just like that. So that's pretty much as simple as it goes to create your distributed application. That's all, folks. There's no more to this demo, but there's a lot of work behind it. You know, it may look simple, and it's really nothing revolutionary. There's other things that do this kind of stuff. The strength of this system that we have is basically combining C++ and JavaScript and asynchronous distributed kind of functionality in a way that's easy to put together. It's really, you know, once you get these systems, they just kind of flow together, and there's a lot of things done in the background that you don't have to worry about. Okay, back to our presentation. So, a few more words. As I mentioned before, there's this product called Machinio. It's an open source, it's Apache licensed. So the big chunk of it is open source. My good friend and colleague Gunther, who started POCO, and he's really the main driving force behind it. I've been just an enthusiast that's hung around for 10 plus years. So there's a big chunk of Machinio that is open source, and OSP and remoting and JavaScript wrapping is still within the Machinio. We did not yank it out, but I really, really do intend to do that because it makes sense. This is kind of like specific to people who do embedded stuff and things like that for, you know, small little embedded devices. What they call Internet of Things these days. So basically, what you can do is you can have your Machinio running on your device, and then you have your sensor networks or, you know, plant floor controllers or whatever you're communicating with, and then you have essentially lots of facilities to transport that data back and forth between your remote, say, mobile interfaces or cloud storage and big data analytics and things like that. And this is where what we've seen before. So Machinio is built on top of that. So that's why, you know, to yank this portion out of that system is relatively straightforward. I did plan to have it before this conference and give you the URL, but unfortunately, life got the better of me. So what you have there is again more services. There's a web user interface. Essentially what you can do is with this thing. And there's a Gunther's presentation somewhere on the internet if anybody's interested. What you can do with this thing is basically it has this web UI. You can create a bundle and say you have this Machinio running on an embedded device, a BeagleBone or Raspberry Pi or whatever, and you can drag that bundle from your desktop to the browser and it will install it automatically. It's pretty cool. And that portion is, yeah, web UI, it's open source. So it's using, what's the Google's HTML, Angular. It's using Angular and jQuery and all those things on the web front end side. So, this product it's open source. The open source portion is Apache licensed. There's a commercial part for those people who are interested. It's built in C++, it's modular, extensible, it is mature, improving code base. We do have a lot of, there's a lot of commercial users that use POCO. I used POCO and OSP at my previous job for probably 7-8 years, did well for us. At my current job, we're using POCO, so we have a lot of people who use it. C++ to JavaScript, which I mentioned before, so you can do Raspberry Pi, BeagleBone, Edison, whatnot, those embedded people do. You can prototype on Linux or OS X. Right now, there's still no Windows support for Machinio. There's no Windows support to build. In other words, there's no complete build system. There is a OSP will build on Windows. There are solutions and everything is there. Machinio doesn't have, I guess Gunther didn't have time to do that, but it builds out of the box on Linux and OS X, and you can just go. You have web interface with JavaScript editor, so you can do basically if you have an embedded device, what this web interface gives you is, you know, you just go to the web page, you can write your little test code, whatever you want to run, and the thing will bundle it up and run it on your embedded device and give you any kind of error or whatever. I think it's pretty cool. So if you're a pro user or you're an embedded developer, these things may be interesting. You have the commercial part has these things that are basically UPnP. SOAP, I believe, is open source. JSON-RPC is not, I think so. And then there's a web interface. You have user authentication, authorization. There are signed bundles if you want to make system secure. Anyway, if you're interested, go to Applied Informatics website. So what did we review today? We reviewed OSP and remoting and web event, and so how it's easy to exchange the data using those three facilities. Also how to exchange data from multiple languages, such as JavaScript. As I mentioned, there is a Python wrapping for OSP, but it's not open source, if anybody is interested. This thing is, the idea is to make it internet age, networking ready. It has good performance for most tasks. Now, it depends what you do. If you do something really, really real time that has a very, very stringent constraints, then of course there are some downsides to it where you can't use it. But for the most things, I've been working in the industrial automation for 15 years. I use these systems for about 7 or 8 years. You can't use it for everything, but for the most things you can use it because most of your data is basically flowing. It's not there's a small portion of it that has this real-time critical kind of nature, but when you want to collect the data, you know, typically it doesn't really all that matter. Whenever you have a human being, you're talking about seconds where you want to see the change on some kind of a screen or when you want to analyze, so you don't need to have it within a millisecond. So in those kind of scenarios, it works good. It's a production tested code. It's used by many, POCO is used by many commercial, and it's used by VMware, it's used by HP. We never hear from them. I guess we write it too well that they don't really need us. The code is so readable and easy that they can just use it. So, I like German cars, I like Italian motorcycles. This is my contact here. And that's all, folks. If you have any questions for me, or if you want to stop by and chat later, and I'll be glad. Yes?
Quick question.
Sure.
So you have RPC on server side between JavaScript and C++. Do you have any thoughts from doing client side RPC calls for the backend?
But that would be JSON RPC. The JSON RPC exists now, but it's not open source. It's Applied Informatics proprietary code, but I believe it's not that big of a challenge to do that. As I said, whatever you want, we'll be very happy to get your pull request. I'll personally commit it if it's good.
And can you repeat the questions, please?
Oh, yes, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
This is probably a little bit of an unfair question, but I've used Qt's web channel. I was just curious, because of the background that I'm kind of looking at this from, I was just curious if you were kind of targeting like
I'm sorry, could you say what was the product?
QT.
Uh-huh. No, I'm not familiar, but I know what QT is, of course. So,
So,
The question was about the QT web channel, I believe, and I know what QT is. I used it very little in the past, and I'm not really familiar with the web channel, so it's probably something similar that we've done, and I'm not surprised because it's really useful functionality, but I'll take a look at it. But I don't know how it differs. You know, details I can't give you. You could probably give me more details than I could give you.
I can give you the QT side. This is the first time I've seen this.
Uh-huh. Thank you.
One more quick question. Is this available as a single bundle that we can download, the OSP and POCO and everything?
Not yet.
Not yet, okay.
But again, hey, you know, if you want to contribute, you know, it's really simple to yank it out.
Instructions on the pieces you need and how to get them together anymore?
how to get hooked. Well, okay, so if you go to Machina.io, so the question was whether this is available as a separate project, and the answer is no, I haven't done it yet. I do plan to do it. It's really simple. Under Machina.io, there's a platform directory that you just copy somewhere and it's all there. It's OSP and there's OSP and then remoting and JS is siblings to OSP under platform in Machina.io. That's what I did for this presentation. I just took that platform and then just wrote a little bit of code for that demo and that was it. Anybody else? Thank you very much for attending. It was my pleasure. See you all this morning.